Meet Andy Knoll, a geobiologist at Harvard University. I talked to him in his office at the Paleontology Museum, and he knows all about the origin of eukaryotes, for example. And he's the author of these two books and others, Life on a Young Planet, Fundamentals of Geobiology. Let's hear what he has to say.
For many years, I've been interested in using the geological record to document the early history of Earth and life. I wrote a book, conveniently right here, called Life on a Young Planet, and that book tries to lay out the procedures by which we interrogated ancient rocks and the kinds of evidence that we used to draw conclusions about the early Earth. Early Earth is kind of a misnomer because it refers to the time of Earth history before the oceans were full of animals that left conspicuous fossils. Now, it turns out that that's about 85% of recorded history. So if you look at our planet's history in its entirety, our biological history is basically microbial.
So are you a microbe?
No, but I have plenty inside my body. If you put a bag around your own body and count all the cells inside that bag, bacteria will outnumber cells of a human being by about 10 to 1. When we walk around, the conspicuous part of our biological landscape are plants and animals, but they are something of the tip of a much larger and more interesting iceberg that is mostly things that are tiny. This is something called a stromatolite, and if you look around the Earth today, the only processes that we know of that are capable of making this kind of structure that will preserve in rocks are processes that involve microbial mat communities. When we see something like this in the rock record, it is a fingerprint of life. And we can see this kind of record back to about these oldest rocks at 3.5 billion years old. So the long and the short of it is that when the curtain goes up geologically, life is already there.
Now, in 2011, you wrote a review entitled The Multiple Origins of Complex Multicellularity. What do you mean by multiple?
When I say that something originated multiple times, I mean that there is no common ancestor of the organisms that have that trait that itself had the trait. That is to say, we have complex multicellularity in animals, we have it in plants, we have it in fungi, we have it in some red algae, but those organisms do not share a common ancestor that was multicellular. Now, it gets more interesting when you think of what exactly are the prerequisites at the cellular level for multicellularity, and they would be things like molecules that make cells adhere to one another. That's the most basic feature of multicellularity.
These are cadherins, I guess?
We'll get back to this. There are cadherins in more advanced animals. Plants adhere by a totally different set of molecules. In fact, in terms of the things that make cells adhere, plants have hemicelluloses, pectins, not all of which are proteinaceous, which cause adherence. And those are very different molecules than the molecules that make animal cells.
Okay, and last question, are we alone?
Maybe. Yeah, I mean, these really are barroom arguments. They're important questions. I don't want to minimize the importance of the question, but it's in some ways it's premature to take a strong stance on issues where we have so little data. So I think I would celebrate the question without pretending we know enough to give an answer at this point.